My name is Tim Marshall. If you don't know me, I'm Provost at the New School, and I'm delighted to welcome you here today for the Tishman Environment and Design Center's faculty grant recipient. This is the first cohort of those, and you're having a panel discussion to celebrate this first cohort of grant recipients. So congratulations to the grantees and look forward to the session. So as I think many of you already know, the Tishman Environment Design Center was relaunched last year with a commitment to lead out the development of new academic programming and research that fosters the integration of design strategies and creative social and ecological approaches to environmental issues. Today, you'll hear from faculty from across the university about research they have conducted over the past year, which applies policy, design, and social justice perspectives to address critical environmental issues generated by the impacts of climate change and other environmental threats to community well-being. The diversity of perspectives, disciplines, and approaches demonstrated by this group of faculty researchers is representative of the wonderful interdisciplinary work being done in every corner of the New School. And TEDC is bringing together scholars from every college in the university, which is certainly music to my ears. Something we're really trying to do, and the fact that all parts of the university, including the performing arts, are now heavily involved. We're just hearing about a faculty member, a jazz musician, who's putting together a piece on global warming, on the heating of the planet as a jazz piece. So I think as people are finding different languages to speak to this common issue is actually a very interesting and important factor that this university is really in the lead of, so it's brilliant. So thank you all for being with us. It promised to be a very stimulating panel discussion. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Anna Baptista. And she has many titles.
Yes.
You do. You're the Associate Director of the Tishman Environment Design Center, the Interim Chair of the Environmental Policy and Sustainability Management Program, and Assistant Professor of Professional Practice at the Milano School of International Affairs, Management, and Urban Policy. That's a lot, Anna. But anyway, thank you.
We're busy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we are.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim. I'm very excited to have these faculty members. It's a rare occasion where we get 6 or 7 faculty members in the same room to present this close to the end of the semester. So it's an exciting day. And really amazing projects that we were privileged to award last year, and looking forward to an annual award that will be announced on Wednesday, right? We're gonna be announcing the new TEDC Faculty Awards for 2016-2017. But today we're gonna give you a little bit of a peek. They won't have time to go deep into their research because we only gave them 12 minutes, so you leave a little time for questions at the end. But they're gonna give you a little taste of some of the work that they did as part of the TEDC Faculty Award grant funding that they received last year. And with us, the award winners last year include Timon McPhearson, who is an assistant professor of urban ecology and chair of the environmental studies program here at the New School, Schools of Public Engagement. And I think I'm gonna do your titles when you come up one at a time, but Nicholas Brynan, who's an assistant professor at Parsons School of Constructed Environments. Timo Rousseau, I'm gonna mess up your name, Rousseau. Assistant Professor of Fashion Design at Parsons School of Fashion. Willi Semmler, who is the Arnhold Professor of International Cooperation and Development at the New School for Social Research. And Ivan Ramirez, who is an Assistant Professor of Environmental Health at Eugene Lang College of Liberal Arts. And coming up on the rear end is myself. I'm going to be presenting, and you heard my title already, so I won't repeat it. It's long enough. And I think we're going to go in order that I just read, and then we'll have time at the end, and I'll take questions from the audience for our speaker. So first up is Timon McPhearson, who's going to be presenting his work called Connect the Dots, Reimagining a Greener, More Connected New York, Ecologically Based Design Solutions for New York City. Thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Anna. Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. And I want to thank TEDC for supporting this work. What I want to talk to you about is definitely a work in progress. This is very much sort of early work incubated because of the TEDC support, something I've been wanting to work on for a long time. And with TEDC, I've been able to do. Connect the Dots is an urban ecology and design project to innovate connections between highly fragmented, disconnected urban green spaces, what we're calling in this study dots. So it's a project, like I said, I've wanted to work on for a long time. And in collaboration with Parsons design students, we have, and I'm presenting basically an early draft of what we're intending as a larger, much more comprehensive design proposal for New York City. And I'll tell you some next steps at the end of the presentation. So I want to highlight first the work of both current and former students, Parsons students here, including Taylor Drake, Chris Heppner, and Josh Snow, who've spent considerable time thinking through with me and drawing, as you'll see, most of this is drawings, how we can achieve what are fundamentally quite ambitious goals. So ecological spaces in New York City, like most cities, struggle because of lack of corridors and connections between parks and smaller green spaces that can allow species and genetic material to move. Now, why does this matter? It matters because New York City and cities all across the world are looking more and more to green space and green infrastructure to help us achieve a number of goals, to make our cities more livable, to make them more resilient to climate change, to make them more sustainable, even for equity goals. So just for example, green spaces in the city help absorb stormwater. They help cool the city, which we need pretty desperately. They help mitigate coastal flooding and surface flooding. They have critical connections to public health, including mental and physical health. And the list seems, as the research grows, to go on and on and on of the benefits of green space. And yet the city is changing constantly, and ecosystems are under constant threat from pollution, from development, from further fragmentation, from climate change, from invasive species, and more. So how do we make sure that they can continue to supply these benefits? How can we make sure that they are ecologically healthy, especially given that we have all of these goals and more goals that keep being placed on our parks and other fragmented spaces? So we're proposing a networked urban ecology that can provide the fundamental ecological and design thinking to advance ways to reimagine a much more connected and greener New York City, delivering enhanced nature-based solutions that we think can help improve access to and mobility within green space for both human and non-human spaces in the city. What you're seeing in these dark green lines that maybe don't pop out so much, the city looks a bit greenish in this tinge, but the point is to emphasize that there's a lot of connections both at the within the city and to large regional ecological reservoirs that we have that currently do not exist. But if we really wanted to be ambitious about what a future New York could look like, could exist, and we want to show how that could happen. So our critical goals here is to do something that I've been thinking about for a long time, which is how do we get these ecological resources that exist at the regional scale and bring them into the city? How do we really enhance the benefits that we could potentially be having from green spaces? So Connect the Dots is fundamentally this ecologically based design project with the goal of delivering a relatively innovative, we think, ambitious, and as you'll see, requires a long-term view for what New York City could be if planners, designers, architects, land managers, residents really took seriously the values that we're placing on urban nature for the various goals that I've mentioned. Now, all urban species, whether they're insects, microbes, mammals, birds, plants, they all require movement. They all require mobility. Mobility is critical for urban pollinators, for example, to locate nectar sources and for small mammals and birds to find food. Some species can move over long distances, but many cannot. And so the basic goal here is to provide better stepping stones, actual physical connections in the city, to help create that movement for the larger ecological health of the ecosystems that we have, to find a strategic way to expand green space, but in a way that's providing this increased connectivity, but and also even to think about genetic diversity and genetic movement through the city. And this is only possible, really, with an enmeshed ecology with design, where designers and urban ecologists are working together, and that's, I think, one of the fun things about this project, working at the local scale. So here, I want to show very quickly three cases where we've zoomed in to say, is this really possible? What would we have to do to actually achieve something like a vision of a much more connected and a much more green New York City? And I want to focus on three quick cases. One in Bayside, Queens, which is an outer suburban area. One in Waterfront, very dense area, near the Queensboro Bridge. And another in the Lower East Side in a high-density residential area with scattered community gardens. So we'll just take the Queensboro case. When we started looking at places where Connect the Dots could be realistically implemented and potentially have high impact in terms of connectivity, we looked at some spaces where we have some really large urban parks, like Alley Pond Park, Cunningham Park, parks that serve a number of goals in the city and yet are physically disconnected and yet still kind of close to each other. They just don't have quite the ecological ability that they might have if we could improve that. So we're asking this question, what could we do to connect this more? So I wanted to show you four different patches we've looked at in this space, A, B, C, and D. As you can see here, when we zoom into this particular area, we're asking questions like, what kinds of movement vectors would species need to have? And how could we work with the existing infrastructure to actually facilitate that kind of movement, working with these particular subpatches? So I'm going to zoom in a little bit further here and say we've been identifying what we're calling critical points, particular corridors between some existing patches that we can start to think about how would we work with the built infrastructure, with the transportation infrastructure, if we wanted to, say, target some kind of green wall or green roof project or something else, but in a strategic way that starts to build this up site by site, building by building across the city. Zooming into these critical points, we can see that we have to know what we're working with, of course. So we've been doing some work to really understand these different areas in terms of the infrastructure that's already there. What are the current ecological conditions of the patches? And think about how we stratify these into some typologies to really conceptualize how we can work with the existing land use and infrastructure. So we need to know about building density, about building height, about the existing ecological spaces, all which play key roles in how species actually can move or don't move through the urban fabric, including things like ground cover and pavement, where the trees are, what kinds of open space, even backyards, low and high buildings, for example. So I'm going to focus in a little bit more here on these different patches. I want to point you to patch C and D here, because we realize that we need to identify the key opportunities in particular neighborhoods. So where can we get the most impact for any kind of particular intervention, given that all of these are going to require significant resources? So we asked, what's there? What are we working with? And here we realized in this neighborhood, it's mostly a bunch of intersections. So there's a theme that maybe can be capitalized on. This is not a novel place in the city. There are many kinds of spaces just like this. So what could we do that might optimize the kind of intersections we might build for a future New York? What could we do in this space that might be able to be spread across the city even more? So if we zoom in on this connection point CD, where essentially in the left here you can see it's basically a large overpass across a very large transportation corridor here with some isolated patches on each side. And what we're trying to do is start drawing some potential vectors and even imagining the kinds of things that could be built in this space in order to connect up the ecological space working with the existing built and transportation infrastructure. So here we just have a gesture as a starting point. Like I said, this is very much a work in progress of the kinds of things we could imagine doing, working with the bridge infrastructure to move across this highly disconnected space as something at a very small site scale intervention that could scale up over time. So when we zoom in on these spaces, we've been focusing on small mammals, birds, and pollinators as a starting point and really trying to understand what would we have to do in that space to facilitate the movement there. How am I doing on time? Okay, great. So I'm going to move quickly and just say in Alphabet City, we've been thinking about it differently. It's high density residential. It's not that same intersection space. We want to move beyond thinking about the horizontal connections and thinking about how do we leverage vertical connections in the city, highly overlooked spaces in the city for potential micro-urban spaces and vertical spaces in the city. And when you do this, you see that these vectors start to become both vertical and horizontal at the same time. It means we start thinking about how can we take advantage of different kinds of overlooked spaces, walls and micro-urban spaces, to start thinking about a very three-dimensional connectivity, about thinking about buildings themselves as the key opportunities, given the density that we have here in New York. And I'm going to move a little bit quickly here to show you my last case in the Queensborough Bridge, which I'd like to tell you a lot more about, thinking at a completely other neighborhood, how we connect up Queens with Manhattan, for example, and thinking about how to start using these transportation networks in a different way. Here we're working with green roofs in particular. There's a lot of flat roofs in this space. We've again realized we need to understand what's happening in this area. So in the top, we've spent our time drawing what's actually there, really understanding what the potential is in terms of the built infrastructure. And then in the middle space, taking this, you can see a thin green line, taking this goal of really connecting in a horizontal way across this infrastructure, and then what would the top of the roofs and the bottom plan really potentially look like? And these are just some fun ideas we're starting to play with here. And then starting to draw all this out, where what would these stepping stones start to look like if we did that? And the right, thinking again about both vertical axes and horizontal axes. And now as we think about how we might scale this up, again, thinking a bit ambitiously perhaps, longer term future, a lot of potential investment here. But the goal of this is hopefully to get some exciting design ideas about what could be possible if we took this seriously, scaling all the way across this neighborhood, across the Queensborough Bridge, into Manhattan, starting to scale that up a bit more, intervention by intervention, slowly across the city, to think about what a much more connected New York City might look like. And I want to show you just a quick 2-minute video, because this has also been taken up as some interesting work by Parsons design students here in the city.
There are ways that people who have maybe a stronger ecological background are starting to think about design, and there are some ways that people who have a design background are thinking about ecology.
I'm about to meet with Taylor, who's getting a BA in Environmental Studies at the Eugene Lang College of Liberal Arts, as well as a BFA in Product Design at the Parsons School of Design. He's combining both of these fields to focus his work on urban ecology.
Can you tell me about how you're in two different programs?
Yeah, so the New School has a cool dual degree program. It's a 5-year program. You get a BFA from Parsons and a BA from Eugene Lang. I think it's beneficial to have an undergraduate degree in both tracks.
One of the exciting things about the Environmental Studies program is the option for students to bring the design skills that they have, that they're getting through Parsons, into the liberal arts space that we have through the Lang program, and then use them in an active research lab, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, it's been an interesting way for me to actually put these skills to actual practice.
I've been looking at areas in which there's either road infrastructure or railway infrastructure, or here some kind of existing green infrastructure that's already present that could be fleshed out a little bit more.
You're calling this connect the dots. In order to connect green spaces, what is the importance of connecting green spaces in an urban landscape?
It increases the health, I think. So to have a better connectivity between patches would ultimately increase the health and ecological productivity of each one of them, because you have species flows. Plant species obviously don't move by themselves. They move by reproduction. So thinking about how a plant might move through the city.
All of these isolated patches, they may not be larger than they were before, but they'll be more connected. And in that sense, the larger population of all of these patches becomes one large green urban patch across the city.
What might a crosswalk look like if it were optimized for non-human species? Right here, especially in intersections like this where several roads come together, it's kind of an opportunity. You have these little corner parks. Even these cobblestone areas right here don't have to be cobblestones, or they could be more integrated even with greenery in between. Functioning healthy ecosystems are actually beneficial in storm resiliency or in heat wave resiliency, or actually they end up having economic benefits. And so the idea is that we're coming up with or looking at ways that you could make an economic benefit out of an ecological benefit as well.
So what's the value in terms of cooling the city? What about in terms of coastal protection? Post Sandy, we realized that loss of wetlands is now a problem, that we want to build some of those wetlands back.
At the beginning, it's hard to imagine connecting these patches in Manhattan because it's such a dense city already. So part of the project has been to challenge the precedent of what a connected green space looks like.
Next up is Nicholas Brennan, who's going to be presenting his work on design, build, public space, street seats design for New York City. And I think we're doing it again this year, right?
Okay, hi everyone. My name is Nick Brennan. I'm a Parsons School of Constructed Environments faculty. So I teach undergraduate architecture and graduate architecture. And ever since I got into architecture, the notion of design build, actually taking a concept, something that could be paper and all other materials, very fantastic, applying the heaviness of those materials, of actual real world consequences, what does that do in changing the way a student thinks? So these projects wouldn't exist without the support of TEDC, but it's allowed us to develop a class from this first project that I'm going to present, which was the street seats. And I hope everybody in here had a chance to sit on that last year. It was just right outside of this building, and I think this building sparked that conversation. As it was being built, we had this huge expanse of sidewalk with not much, like social activity on the south facade of this building. Beautiful facade, but not much in terms of street engagement on the level of us humans. That allowed the DOT to come in and ask some questions about, you know, can there be bike parking? Can there be certain types of infrastructure that can maybe facilitate the use of these areas other than just a parking spot or several parking spots? So somehow this conversation, just to give you a little bit of the backstory, trickled down to me. It went from dean to dean. I think Joel Towers somehow intercepted an email, then passed it all along to some other deans of schools, and then found its way to me to participate in this program called the Street Seats, which is a Department of Transportation program. It evolved from the 2010 Downtown Alliance and their innovative, those little squares are supposed to be quotation marks, pop-up cafe initiative on Pearl Street. And what it does is basically takes several parking spots or a space in front of a storefront and creates a seasonal public space with seating, tables, certain amenities that people can just go in and sit at and occupy, kind of like a small park. So as I said, it can temporarily replace parking spots, standing zones, and it's still not clear what the convention is for it, what the design should be. So the Department of Transportation came to us to see if students could maybe re-envision what that little pocket of space could be, how big it could be, how could it be designed. The things that were required was obviously reaching the Department of Transportation guidelines, the community board too. So this is where I had to put my architecture skills into effect and present to the community board. So after several meetings with them, we now have blanket approval to use that space every year as sort of a laboratory to study how that space can be redesigned. And then obviously the new school and the facilities department approval from them. It's all signed and sealed by either a licensed architect or engineer, not affiliated with the new school. And so again, it's seasonal. So it's dismantled, it's sort of built, and we'll look at some examples in a minute, but it's built and then it's dismantled. And there is a question of what happens when it's gone to the materials, to the space, et cetera. So this is the spot I'm talking about right here on the south side of this building. When I really got approval from everyone, it started off as just a club. So I would just ask my students, I would just yell to the whole studio, it's an open studio in the architecture department, who's interested in building something? No credits, no pay for me. It was kind of like, we're gonna do this instead of watch TV or a football game or something. So when we finally did get funding from TEDC and another group, which now no longer exists, called the Green Fund, we had some money so I could buy some pizza to entice students to come and draw and build models and to really just have a conversation and use what they're doing in class. So we sit around for an hour, have pizza, they'd get fed, and we'd come up with ideas. Then I would sort of provoke them or prod them to put it into the more sophisticated systems that they use and that actually allowed them to practice what they were doing in their studios. Again, not trying to interfere with their actual classes, but just getting them to exercise what they were already learning. And so we came up with a great design. We presented it to the community board. The community board loved it. And then it became a question to go from this, which was a bit more provocative and conceptual, to, well, how's it actually going to be built? And even still, this drawing, as you see the photos in this sort of 3D model, don't quite align. And that's where I think there's this great fuzzy part about actual materials, unlevel surfaces, topography, and things like that, that we, as much as we tried and do the professional drawing and the precision of our drawings, it's not until we get out on site that a Jeep Cherokee was parked there for 6 days with tickets. And so now we realize, wait, so how are we gonna build this if this car is here? And this was the first day. You can kind of see all the tickets on the dash. Well, not so much up there. But this car had about 6 tickets. So we had the new school tow the car. And we actually built this project in that one day. So using the shops and all the facilities after the last day of classes, we fabricated, numbered, created our system for all of our materials, and began to build. And so it was a group of about 8 or 9 students, and we were just out on the streets. People would come by and talk to us. And we built this in one day with the plan and our numbering system of how to kind of think of this as a platform level with the sidewalk, and how does it become something safe and sort of cool that you want to inhabit. So it's a simple system of stacked lumber and a metal grating, and trying to think of materials we see every day. So in this case, the notion of grating for subway drainage that we see on the street, how can we take that and invert it and create, you know, a different type of guardrail, different interaction with that? And then the notion of lumber, something like scaffolding we see, you know, in that far right-hand corner. How do we take lumber and begin to create sort of a lace out of it, but also something that can seem protective and sturdy in terms of a guardrail? Then we bought some simple tables and chairs, tried to experiment with different vegetation throughout the spring and summer, which that was a test itself. Vegetation died, we tried something else. But it became very successful. We started to see people, we started to see waiting lines, people waiting to eat breakfast there every day, people using it in a different way, moving tables and chairs. So I think there's an opportunity for even other disciplines to come in after this is designed and built, let's say by even more students, let's say product design, interior design, architecture, urban design, but to also get some social aspect, to begin to study what does a pocket of space do to energize and activate intersections such as this. So that really concludes it. It was dismantled in this past November. And from this project, a class has actually developed within Parsons in the School of Construction Environment. And so now a new design is being worked on. In fact, I think this week it'll be built, or next week, or sometime very soon. But things we like to explore. So recently that class has been handed off to two great brothers, a product designer and an architect, Granger Moorhead and Robert Moorhead. And some of the things in talking to them to pass this project off into an actual class was, let's look at fabrication techniques, all the tools and great machines and technology we have at this school. How can the students use that and facilitate that way of making and learning? Definitely look at different materials. Again, it's a seasonal thing. So at the end of this project, all the materials were recycled. They went to a place called Rocking the Boat, which is in the Bronx. It's a program where high school students build boats and actually become certified carpenters. So it's obviously for at-risk youth, but it's a great program. They build boats, so they took all the lumber. They were gladly took all the lumber. The pedestal system, the base, is actually being used again. So it's a ipe wood, very sturdy. It's going to be used again for the next iteration. And then our metal grating actually also went to Rocking the Boat to become ramps to help them launch the boat. So they took the grating, actually used it what it's supposed to be used for, to walk on, and created sort of a walkway to launch their boats into the Bronx River. So exploring material options becomes this seasonal thing, this temporary thing that we really want to think about and not leave a huge footprint, but leave a maximum footprint at the moment, at the time that this is in place. Another one was vegetation. That severely has to be studied because, you know, we had some failures and we're trying to figure it out. Identity and graphics for the community, but also for the new school. Maybe opportunities for shading or albedo control, solar controls. And then we just had a tree cut down right there. I don't know if anybody noticed its absence. But how do we begin to use that little piece of soil and maybe a new tree in the landscape in the design conversation? So this is what the class, it's not my class. This is, again, Granger and Robert. But this is what they're going to build in just a week, I think, or at the end of this week. This is basically sonotube. It's a very heavy-duty cardboard foundation. It's poured for like decking. It's the concrete foundation for piers and decking. So it's very inexpensive. You can get it at Home Depot. But the idea that these could be planters or soft surfaces that one could sit on is, I think, an ingenious idea. And it's something you can begin to see weather over time and maybe test the plants out and see how they begin to maybe overgrow this thing. But this is basically what we could expect. And that's it. Thanks.
Great. So next up, we have Timo Risanen. And he is going to talk to us about designing endurance, investigating user-centered fashion design, the use of clothes in a design context.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here. And thank you, TEDC, for the funding. It's really allowed me to expand my research into in ways that I don't expect to have been able to were it not for the funding this year. So I am really, really grateful. This project really builds on a number of things that I've worked on over the last decade, in part my PhD research, which was on zero-waste fashion design, and then also a project which I'll touch on briefly in a minute called Local Wisdom that Parsons participated in 2012 to 2014, which I led. It was a seven-university project led by London College of Fashion and Professor Kate Fletcher. And as well as LCF, there were six partner universities around the world, and Parsons was one of them. And so this project really builds on some of the ideas and some of the findings of that research as well. And really looking at what it means for fashion design to look at how people actually use clothing. Just to give you one example, if you look at the life cycle of a T-shirt or a shirt, for example, up to 80% of the environmental impact can be just through due to laundering. So understanding how people launder things is actually very important in a design context. And my project, as this first slide kind of hints, also focuses on repair. And the shirt that I'm wearing is kind of another example. You'll see an earlier incarnation of this shirt in a minute. Some of you remember Cameron Tonkinwise or know Cameron Tonkinwise. He was here at Parsons for a long time. And this is from a paper that he wrote more than a decade ago, which has been a kind of a guiding statement for a lot of the work that I've done. He was calling for designers to design timely things, things that can last longer by being able to change over time. Design things that are not finished, things that can keep on by keeping on being repaired and altered, things in motion. And it really is this idea of things in motion that underlies the research that I am undertaking at the moment. And then I mentioned local wisdom. This is one of the diagrams that was developed in the sort of final stages of the project in 2014. And since then, Kate Fletcher has actually, the book has just come out last week in the UK called Craft of Use, Post-Growth Fashion, and it will be out here in the US in May. And Parsons is also featured in that book. But the two things to kind of draw, that I want to draw your attention to in this diagram are sort of in the top right, the post-growth economics section, and then in the bottom left, the section on use practices. And that really is where my research is fitting in. And particularly in the use practices. So in fashion, we do sell garments as a product, but they then are really lived as a process. And that process is what I'm really interested in, and what that process actually, or what understanding that process actually means for fashion design. Because if you think about it, in America, an average consumer buys up to 68 garments per year and 7 pairs of shoes per year. And that is not something that we can actually sustain in the longer term. And when you look at some of the developing economies, if there is an aspiration to be consuming at that level, then certainly we're heading to a future where we will need to look at other ways of doing fashion business that is not relying on such huge quantities of product turnover. In my research, I've also looked at a lot of historical practices around clothing because this particular moment in fashion is a fairly recent one. So some of you probably are familiar with the term fast fashion, and that really is the dominant experience of fashion for many people, and it certainly is the facet of the industry that is dominant in the commerce of fashion. But the thing to remember about it too is that it's a fairly new phenomenon. It's a phenomenon that's really existed for the last 15 to 20 years. And so for partly for that reason, I have looked back in time as well to understand other kinds of practices of around the use of fashion. This particular example is from Japan, and it's about 100 years old. It's from a place called Awaji Island in the south of Japan. And there's a little museum that has several of these coats, and through oral histories and other methods, the researchers at the museum have been able to ascertain that some of these coats were actually worn in the same family for up to 100 years. So they were passed from father to father. This was a small fishing village, and these coats were actually worn by the fishermen. And passed from father to son over many generations. And as you can see, they were being repaired throughout that time until a point where all you can see in the garment is actually repair. So if you think back to the quote from Cameron Tonkinwise at the start, I think this is a garment that captures that quote quite beautifully in a visual form. And at the same time, you know, this garment existed in a very particular cultural context and a very particular historical context, which neither of which are not necessarily relevant here in New York today. So that's where my interest is. How do we, or is it in fact possible to adopt some of these ideas around very, what I call super long use life and explore them in a contemporary fashion design context? And that's really what my project is looking at. So this idea of a super long use life, whatever that might be for a specific user. Here's one example that was uncovered in the Local Wisdom Project in the UK. This man's name is Edward, and you'll see another image of him in a minute. But if you just focus on the back, and particularly the knitted panel through the center back of this garment, and here's the actual story of it. So just to... I'll go through the story very quickly. So Edward calls this his three-stage jacket. It began about 40 years ago as a very slim waistcoat. And then when he put on some weight, he split the back and added that knitted panel into it. And then about 15 years ago, he started going to a folk dancing group in a place called Chorlton, which is near Manchester. And so in order to make this garment appropriate for the folk dancing that he was doing, he added the trims that you see around the collar and particularly the bottom of the back. And he also added the sleeves. And Edward is actually in his 80s, and just the idea that there's this 80-year-old man who knits, I think, is... wonderful. And in fact, in Local Wisdom, we uncovered many such delightful stories from around the world, including here in New York. Some of you may have participated in the interviews in the lobby of 2 West 13 in January 13. And then, as you can see, only about 5 years ago, he put on some more weight. And that's when he added these, I think they're leather latchets that he calls them, because you can actually see the original buttonholes and the buttons on the front, which no longer fasten the garment. Instead, it's held together by these things that he calls latchets, which is not a word that I've ever come across in fashion elsewhere. And I have had some experience with it. And so if any of you are interested, the Local Wisdom site, which is the first URL, has hundreds of these stories from around the world, from the UK, the US, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and Denmark and Norway. And they're categorized in different kinds of use practices. And one of them is repair, which is perhaps the main focus of my research. I'm really interested in on one hand, the practices of repair, because some of those practices tend to be a little bit forgotten. Certainly, the kinds of repair that my grandmother would do, for example, a lot of those things are no longer done in my native Finland. And I remember when I did an early presentation on repair back in 2008, when I was still living in Australia, and did this presentation in a very similar setting to this to my colleagues and some graduate students, and it was about repair. And when it came time to questions, one of my colleagues put her hand up and said, why would I repair anything? It's just easier to go and buy a new garment. And that was actually brilliant to hear that at that point, because often the barriers to repairing things and to prolong the use life of things, they are actually social in nature and not technical in the sense that I had understood them to be. Because up until that point, I had approached repair purely as a technical endeavor. And that has often been the case for a lot of the research that has happened in relation to sustainability in fashion. It has focused on the technical aspects. And it's not to say that those aspects aren't important, but it is also important to understand the social aspects of it, and that's where my research is now focusing on. And so what I'm doing is I'm actually making versions of this shirt. This is the same shirt that I'm wearing. That's what it looked like in 2009. 7 years later, it has been repaired a number of times, so the white stitching that you see around it is repair, and there's already new holes that have appeared. There's something at the back. And so it's in this constant state of needing to be repaired and being repaired. And so the four participants, I expect to work with them for a number of years. I did some in-depth interviews in the fall with them to create the to get a sense of what would be a satisfying shirt for them. And they are about to get their shirts in the next month. It's been a slower process than I anticipated because turning this zero-waste shirt, so another facet of this is none of the fabric that is used to make the shirt is actually wasted. It all ends up in the garment itself. It has been, to do custom-made zero-waste shirts is actually, just from a design point of view, is incredibly challenging. And this is some process photos. And then I'll just finish with the other facet of this, which is the experimental research methods, which is what this grant has allowed me to do. So in December, I was able to do a week-long intensive workshop with four performance artists from Finland who have actually been collaborating with different scientists for a number of years, including cosmologists and so forth. And really, my intention there is to find a new language for research around fashion and sustainability. So over that week, we did very intense exercises. For example, on the second day that this photo and the following photo are from, we did 25 performances between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. And they were not pre-planned. We did them, some of you recognize the room from 55 West 13. And we taped it all. So right now, I'm also analyzing 30 hours worth of footage from that week, which actually got very deep into some of these issues. So I'll just finish with these garments here. One of our homework for the first day of the workshop was to bring 10 garments that had lost their meaning. And so I had four people bringing what they called suitcases of nonsense from Finland. This is actually on one of the tapes. Just so we could talk about why these garments had lost their meaning. So there were actually 40 garments that were brought from Finland for this very purpose. And it's already proving incredibly rich in terms of getting to the understanding of why we actually let go of things and why we throw things away, particularly in a fashion context. So I will finish with that. And over the next year, you will see two. So I'm working towards two papers out of the project. One is very much on user-centered fashion design, and the other one is on experimental research methods in fashion design research. So thank you very much.
And next, we'll have Willi Semmler, who will be talking to us about his research burden sharing of climate politics, adaptation policies, and funding climate resilience.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much for this particular. I want to thank the TEDC for the grant and the fellowships, and I could do very useful things. Maybe they are a little bit different from what you heard up to now. I'm an economist, and economists always think about, well, they're great projects and wonderful projects, but most of those need some money, need some funding, some financial resources, right? So I'm thinking about this, and this was my contribution here, or what I got some funding for. Well, now if you think about climate change, which has a short and long run impact, but it's caused by certain things, I will talk about this briefly. But climate policies are usually undertaken through issue some cap and trade, so firms can buy some right to pollute the environment, or firms one has some taxes, carbon tax on those products that have emit a lot of carbon. One can introduce some regulation, one can give incentives to some development of green energy, but all this costs money and needs funds. And the question came up, so to speak, about the cost and benefits of those activities. The cost of the climate change effects may be large for certain groups, for certain regions, for certain coastal regions, for certain situation where you have extreme weather events. And so it always has some distributional and employment effects. So what we use as finance, so to speak, climate preventing climate change, and what we use for adapting to climate change. I won't talk much about how to include this into economic models. There's a long tradition that's called integrated assessment models, but I will leave this mainly out. So my main point is this idea is that in current discussion, most of the burden of climate change, so to speak, is put on current generation. And now we started thinking about, partly by in paper initiated by Jeffrey Sachs, well, maybe one should include future generation as well. So that might be very controversial, but it's some starting point of a discussion. So my main point here is, well, I got a lot of funding from the TEDC, and I can use this for a lot of corporations that I'm involved in. I've also recently published this handbook with Lucas Bernhard on the macroeconomics of global warming. There's a leaflet there where you can look at this, where it's published. And there are lots of graduate students involved in climate change project that I'm doing at the SEPA. Here's the number of students, former students and current students involved. So this fund is useful for also supporting student innovative work in climate change. Now, just a quick remark. So climate change has its origin, probably starting in the 19th century, where the increasing greenhouse gas emissions, so these are 10,000 years, you can see since roughly the 1850s, the greenhouse gas emission is shooting up a lot, and here it is shown again. This is the wrong way. So this way. And this is a nice picture done by some other experts, where you see since the middle of the 18th century with industrialization, so to speak, you can see the climate, the temperature is going up. Here it's roughly 1 degree. Here's a more detailed level presentation there. The 1 degree isn't so much the problem. The problem is the extreme weather events that are occurring, or extreme events that are occurring with a rising temperature. That's what the climate scientists tell us. And so I'm going the wrong way. So the temperature may rise, for example, from zero now to one more degree, two, three, 4 degree. And it has huge, what we already saw now in the presentation, impacts on the water system, on the ecosystem, city system, both the living conditions in cities or rural areas, flooding at coastal areas, and impacts on health. And what I said, the main dangerous is impact is the extreme events that can come. Going the wrong way always. So the main, you could ask, well, what are the main, so to speak, polluters or culprit who was causing this? Well, if you look at the data, most of the tons of carbons come from the use of coal. So this is, so to speak, what's still in the earth below this line, and this is what above, what's already used or potentially used pretty soon. And the next one, big polluter, is oil, and the next one is gas. But here is the biggest polluter there. And this is well recognized now in the climate research. Now, there's another thing coming now. one gets some slowly increasing temperature, but there seem to come some tipping points. And the tipping point theory is developed by Hansen. We wrote also a paper on this, and he says, well, such an ice sheet tipping points can ice sheet disintegration, vegetation migration, greenhouse gas release from soils, tundra, ocean sediments, and so on. They come slowly in, and then there may be a tipping point with rapid ongoing climate changes, realization that Earth is out of energy balance, implying more warming is in the pipeline, so warming causes more warming. And this is called the tipping point problem in climate change. We have tried to model this a little bit. One or two graphs are in it. So in other words, what the Hansen theory means, if the Earth absorbs energy more slowly, more and more energy, then it reflects back to space, then, so to speak, the with an increasing temperature, the energy being absorbed will rise. And so if the energy being absorbed will rise, one gets these tipping points, a collapse of large-scale ice sheets, a large-scale change of ocean circulation, release of locked-in carbon in tundra or in permafrost or in the ocean, and warming triggers more warming. And this could produce these extreme events, acceleration of damages, sea level rise, flooding, severe droughts, food losses, desert formation, storms, hurricane, and damages to ecosystem much more than we saw. So this is basically what could go on after the tipping point. Now, why is that the case? Well, people say, well, the cost of fossil energy is just, or the price is just too low, and one should put a tax on this. And so if we look at this graph, we can say, well, the cost of fossil fuel is above this, around here, but the cost of renewable energy, is here, but the cost of renewable energy is there. So renewable energy is more expensive than fossil fuel. But what one forgets that we have all these externality effects and greenhouse gas emission and possibly all the damages that will be occurring with fossil fuel. Therefore, the price of fossil fuel should go up actually to here. And if one does this, as you can see, our renewable energy becomes much cheaper as compared when you take into account all the environmental and long-run climate effects from fossil fuel, use of fossil fuel. And Jacobson particular points this out. He gave a talk at the SEPA once. Now, what do I mean with now with cost, with burden sharing? Just a few points. Well, there's a cost from impacts of climate change, as you saw, with these extreme events. The impacts, I list them here again. And there is a cost of climate policies. So when one want to move to renewable energy or want to increase the carbon tax, or increase the carbon price through using a carbon tax, then, of course, that means a cost. The price will rise. And this also means that there will be some uneven distribution of this cost. Yeah. So now, coal mines are closing. Well, they are closing a few days ago. One of the biggest coal mines went bankrupt. Then oil companies also go bankrupt at the moment. It's not necessarily through the climate policy, it's already through the low oil price that is occurring. But that means huge adjustment costs for this region where the people are employed there, right? So, if power plants have to raise prices, so to speak, due to carbon tax, well, certain households, low income households, will have to pay a bigger percentage of their income than high income and more wealthy households, right? So gasoline price goes up in the gas station, okay, then it will be also a differential impact. So what we have now thought about that there should be some burden sharing of the cost of climate change in for the current generation, but also for the future generations. So future generation means, well, there is a... if we let the, business as usually go on, this will be so roughly, so it's somewhat a simulation result, this will be the carbon emission emissions there. This will be the wealth or capital stocks that one has. Now, if one introduces now, introduces now a carbon tax, in particular also bonds, it's nowadays relatively easy to issue green bonds or climate bonds. And the climate bonds are, so to speak, issued now. You can use the income and revenue from this to pay for mitigation or adaptation policies, but it will be paid back in future by future generations. So if we do this, in the second stage, as you can see, now the CO2 emission and goes down, and the wealth or capital stock goes up, it's higher. But there will be, of course, an increase in debt, sovereign debt, so through fiscal policies. But this will be repaid by future generations. On the left-hand side, this is again by future generations, where you have now a tax in future for future generations, because their income, their wealth has increased as well, and their welfare has increased, and they should somewhat also be included in some payments for the keeping the environment cleaner and avoid climate change. And so the tax is being paid and the debt is going down. So I know it's very controversial to, so to speak, to burden future generations that are not there yet, but they're also living at a higher level of income at that later time period and don't have the pollution effects or the climate change effects. So this was an idea that we developed, and one can basically say, well, the funding of this and all these wonderful projects need some funding. One can do some carbon tax, but also issue some bonds against this. And this will help to raise revenues. This will help to the transition period to get to more green economy. And this will help also against adapting against big climate events. So this is our basic idea that we developed. It's published. It's coming out in one journal already. This is was my last slide. Just one remark, some advertisement. So we have at the CEPA, this is the Center for Economic Policy, Schwarz Center for Economic Policy Analysis at the NSSR, a large number of lectures there in recent times from environment, from renewable energy to the big extreme events that are occurring in the local regions, also in the US, and effects of extreme weather events. And we will have soon now a new lecture advertisement now from May 23rd. Edenhofer from the IPCC was one of the leading figures in Paris. He will talk about climate policy after Paris. And there will be a new jazz piece performed, world premiere, on the warming earth that Tim Marshall has announced. It will come at this event. So you're all invited to come there. OK, thank you.
Thank you, Willi. Next, we have Ivan Ramirez, who will be talking to us about temporal discontinuities of cholera emergence in northern Peru. Should we blame climate change?
First of all, thank you for inviting me to this panel, and TEDC for the funding. It's helped with, first of all, acknowledging that the work's important, and helping me to disseminate some of these results, some contribute to some ongoing work in Peru and some new work in New York City. And what I'll be presenting today is actually a publication that just came out this month based on previous work and ongoing work that TEDC funded. And the overall goal of the TEDC funded project was to look at synergies between climate and social factors of vulnerability on human health in two urban areas. New York City being a new project which would focus on chronic diseases, and in Piura, Peru, focusing on disease emergence of infectious diseases. What I'll be presenting today is just a segment of it that looks at cholera emergence. It's a retrospective study looking at cholera emergence in the 1990s and what lessons it offers for us. Particularly what I'll be doing is focusing on the importance of time and change. And one of the reasons that I kind of would like to talk about that today, and I also kind of shifted a little bit of the work to focus on Peru, is because we're currently at the tail end of an El Nino event, which is a disturbance in the tropical Pacific Ocean, which happens every few years and has implications for local weather patterns around the world. And we're right at the tail end, and that has actually opened up a number of opportunities for me, invited talks and a number of different things, including the publication that just came out in EcoHealth. So I'll be sharing you with some of the initial results and also what some of the future work is. So why is this work important? There's many reasons, but one, if we're putting in the context of climate change, is that climate change is anticipated to impact the spread or the geographic spread and range of a lot of infectious diseases. Of course, there's a lot of other health-related impacts. And that would be something that's in the future, although now we're finding documentation that there's some evidence that that's possible, that climate change has actually already contributed to that, as well as a number of other effects. The current El Nino right now, which is finishing up, and we're actually going to shift into another phase of El Nino called La Nina fairly soon. And I'm actually working on writing a proposal so that I can jump on that, not to TEDC, but to an external funding agency. So El Nino has a lot of implications for health because of its impacts on weather patterns around the world, but also marine ecosystem and coastal changes that it contributes to. Some changes, you could say, may have been associated with the warmer weather, in part, that we experienced this past winter here in New York City. So we can feel it as far away as the Northeast. So to simplify the research question I'm looking at today and talking about, and there's two hypotheses, is, well, did climate contribute to cholera emergence and resurgence in the 1990s in northern Peru? And actually, by focusing on time, I'm actually being critical of the climate connections. It's not simply that rising temperatures or rains lead to contamination of water or the spread of infectious diseases. It's actually more complicated, and we have to really think about the timing. So the hypothesis is that cholera incidence was linked to climate, but this relationship was inconsistent. It's transient, and that's based on what we see in the literature in terms of understanding climate patterns and also in understanding epidemics as well. And the second hypothesis is that climate or even disease incidence or emergence is also mediated. So when we think about climate, we've got different scales. We've got the global climate, and we've got local climate, regional climate that we feel. The Pacific Ocean is far away. New York City has its own regional and local climate. So does northern Peru as well, even though it's very close to that Pacific Ocean. So we propose that, or we hypothesize that, links from the Pacific Ocean to inland disease incidents are linked through local weather, temperature and rainfall, although I'll focus on rainfall today. This is a map of the study area. I'm really interested in this area of northern Peru. It's called Piura. And Piura is very interesting because El Nino actually originates there. That's where the name comes from. The fishermen noticed that warm waters would come every few years, and not just by visibly looking at different ecologies, but by touching the water. It's much warmer water. And then that was followed by torrential rains on the coast. And so I chose this study area because of that, but because also cholera emerged there in the 1990s, and Piura was one of those first places where it was documented. It's approximately 1,000 kilometers north of Lima, and it's a coastal environment that has a low-lying area in the west, and then as you start moving east, you hit the foothills of the Andes. So the ecosystem does change, although predominantly we're going to be talking about the low-lying coast. This is Piura, and in comparing Piura and Peru, they follow very similar patterns in terms of cholera incidence. And we log transformed the data here so that we can visualize it better. And this is from 1991 to 2001. And you can see that there are a lot of cases here. This is actually approximately, in the country, there was more than 300,000 cases. In Piura, there were, I don't recall now, but I think it's approximately 16,000 cases in the first year. And you see that it decreases over time, and then it increases in 1998. And that's associated with a very strong El Nino that began in March of or May of 1997. And many people have compared the current El Nino to that El Nino as well, and to some degree anticipate some of the same effects, which actually can be problematic to do that. The emergence was also linked to El Nino, and that's actually what got me really interested in this, is that I was interested in social and health effects, and Peru captured my attention because of the El Nino timing. And when you look at the data and just start to examine the case very carefully, there's something wrong with the timing. And that's where I always had, there's a disconnect between when the event began and when the epidemic began. And that's where that really motivated me, and motivated more when I actually got to Peru, and there was some evidence of that disconnect in the local population. And it was very interesting. Just briefly on cholera ecology. Cholera is caused by a bacterial agent called Vibrio cholerae. It causes watery diarrhea, vomiting, and can lead to dehydration and death if not addressed quickly. But it also can take on mild forms, and to some degree, in some places, you may not actually experience symptoms, but you can still transmit the disease through defecation, especially if you're in a place where there's weakened or inadequate infrastructure. Vibrios are very interesting because they live in the natural environment. And I would say that probably in the 90s and 2000s, we had a paradigm shift because we now understand, we once thought that Vibrios needed humans as hosts as part of this disease transmission process. And now we realize that Vibrios can live in the natural environment and reproduce without us, which is very interesting, and also for public health alarming, because it's difficult to then actually eradicate or address it. They actually live in symbiotic relationships with aquatic organisms in coast and water environments and in marine systems. And these are some of the aquatic reservoirs, which are actually really important for marine and coastal ecosystem food chains, and also to climate change. There's a lot of photosynthesis going on. And cholera is transmitted when humans drink contaminated water or eat contaminated food. So this amoeba-like looking structure are some of my results. And what this is showing you, and this is a time series analysis, and this is by months from January 1991 all the way until December of 2001, comparing cholera incidents with ocean temperatures, actually in the Central and Eastern Pacific Ocean, SST. And this is showing you on the, that's on the x-axis. On the y-axis, we've got multiple scales, cycles of periodicity, from 0.25 years to 0.5 years to 1 year, 2 years, 4 years. If you're looking for an El Nino connection, you're going to look at the upper scales. And that's what we see here to some degree. And what's interesting here is that what we found is that in the latter half of the 1990s, we have a different pattern from the earlier 1990s. We don't have any statistically significant correlations here. The red indicates strong correlations, and the black lines means that statistically they were significant and not random. And this is most likely associated with the 1997-98 El Nino, which is what previous studies have shown, actually, but many have never actually tested this aspect. It was assumed that because we found connections here, that it was also true here. But that's not necessarily true. There is a delay of, okay. we found that there's a time lag between sea surface temperatures, and which is consistent with the literature. And we also looked at rainfall, and rainfall shows a similar pattern there, except at multiple scales, from local, smaller cycles to higher cycles, multi-year. And the time lag is much shorter. We proposed a method or a model based on this that local rainfall mediates cholera. We actually tested it, and we found statistically significant results for that as well. And it's most likely that this is mediated or facilitated through flooding, which leads to contamination of water supply in this low-lying, actually desert environment. So what's our conclusions? We found that there's a strong and discontinuous El Nino cholera link, and it's mediated by hydrometeorology. We found no evidence of El Nino in the early 1990s, which actually contradicts a longstanding hypothesis. And lessons for public health is that climate change and climate variability and extremes may have some influence on cholera, but they can change over time. And there's a number of different reasons that they can change. There are other explanatory factors, which I can discuss, not discuss, but present to you right now. One is social factors are not considered. Two, biological immunity changes over time. And the El Niños themselves also vary in their strength and how they develop across places. So you might anticipate that the ecology may also not follow as well or not be consistent. Okay, I can stop there. All right, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Last but not least, hopefully everyone's still awake and ready to ask lots of questions for our panel. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the research I did last summer with an organization called the Climate Justice Alliance. This is an organization that has over 40 member groups throughout the country, mostly what we call frontline communities, communities of color, low-income communities throughout the country, burdened by environmental pollution and climate change. I've worked with this organization. I was part of the member group for many years, and they actually came to the New School 2 years ago for the People's Climate March, and we helped host a two-day People's Climate Summit where they held a tribunal and interacted with activists throughout the world on issues of climate justice. So it was a good starting point. We had a conversation around what would be some useful points of reflection to co-produce. So this was really a participatory action research. We developed the questions together. And the organization was at an important time, post-climate march, thinking about COP21 and what the activities were of their member groups throughout the country. And they really wanted to look at a reflection of how their member organizations were looking at this issue of a just transition. Transition to a fossil-free economy, and what they were putting into practice, what they were implementing on the ground, what were some of the models that were being developed, and even more importantly, what were some of the ideas that were being articulated? You know, how did people understand this idea of a just transition and their role in it as local frontline communities? And one other thing we kind of threw in there was also this idea of scale. We really wanted to look at how these local communities are dealing with sort of transnational alliances with groups around the world and thinking about systems change grounded in local activities. So we did some interviews. We spent the summer interviewing over 24 people across 8 organizations in 6 locations. And these are what Climate Justice Alliance calls the Our Power communities, the Our Power pilot communities. They've particularly identified these 8 organizations for doing intensive work around just transition and climate work. So these are groups that have been around for many decades working on environmental justice and climate issues in their respective communities. They're very active and engaged, sophisticated organizations. So they have become, for the last 3 years, have been working on developing Our Power campaigns, locally based campaigns around climate and just transition work. So I won't get into all of them. So I'm gonna touch on a couple of the key lessons or best practices that came out of that research. One was this idea of articulating what is a just transition. This term that's used quite frequently, I think more frequently now than, certainly it was a term used in the labor movement to describe the shift in economies and what happens to the workers who are displaced from economies that are and industries that are transitioning. And many times it's referred or thought of as how do we transition from a fossil fuel-based economy to a quote-unquote greener economy. So people think, you know, what happens to all the coal miners and the power plant workers that no longer will have jobs as we transition to, into deep decarbonization. But the just transition vision that many of the communities in CJA articulate go further. They're not talking about a greener, gentler form of capitalism. They are really looking at more radical transformations, or at least they're articulating those in economic systems and how they relate to work, how they relate to their environment, really transforming the economy and their relationship to that economy. So a lot of the communities talked about, yes, they talked about transitioning out of fossil fuel-based economy, and they talked about solar and wind industries, but they also talked about a broad swath of other issues that I didn't anticipate, actually, when I went in. I thought they were all going to tell me about all the solar panels they're installing in their communities. And they're like, no, we're doing all sorts of things. You know, we're looking at governance systems. We're looking at solidarity economy models. We're looking at how do we bring large portions of the communities that were never part of the economy to begin with. So they didn't have the jobs in the coal mines or the power plants. They were very disenfranchised from those sectors. And so they've been underemployed or underrepresented in the economic systems. So they really want to talk about how do we get more of a stake in economic systems. How do we actually think about the systems of production and consumption and how who controls them and can we control them? You know, they're going a little bit deeper. And so when I asked the folks that we interviewed, you know, how do you envision, you know, just transition and what are you, what is your community, what is your organization working on in terms of implementing just transition work, I got a very wide array of answers. We did have folks who were working, like I said, in the energy sector, working on energy cooperatives, community-owned utilities, and that sort of thing. But then there were a lot of others who talked about doing restorative work and cultural work, particularly in the indigenous communities hit by coal mining. Many of them talked about organizing local communities and working in various sectors, not just the energy sector, reconstituting local economies that might have been forgotten, like regional wool markets or food economies, looking at how can they have locally based microeconomies that they can have more access to, and that will hopefully be more sustainable. So some of them talked about zero waste, working in the composting and zero waste industries. Some talked about more traditional paths like public transportation and state-based investments and state-driven investments. So it was a very diverse field of or thinking about just transition. And these bullets here, one of the organizations, Kentuckians for the Commonwealth, actually developed a framework, Principles of Just Transition. And they put all of their projects and campaigns through this lens of, does it meet our principles of a just transition? And these are some of the questions they ask when they look at projects or campaigns or investments that they're going to make in the community. I think I'm going to touch on, I'm just going to highlight a couple of the organizations to display some of the models that they're using on the ground. Certainly all of the organizations have a deep, rich tradition of organizing, and they're organizing not just in their local base, but they're organizing across cultural and racial identities. So organizing in the Black community from Detroit to Mississippi, or organizing the Asian Pacific Islander networks across the country. Many of them are working on energy democracy and looking at how they can sort of take back control of energy production and energy distribution systems. Almost all of them are working in some form on policy and legislative reforms that they hope will be models for drawing investment and other types of state intervention than what they've had in the past. Many of them are working on the right to land and land sovereignty. And democratic practices. So in terms of land use, one of the interesting organizations we interviewed was this group called Cooperation Jackson, which is in Jackson, Mississippi, one of the poorest states in the country and one of the poorest cities in that state, mostly African American. And this community took on this issue of land use and control of land. They had a mayor Mayor Lumbaba that was leader in the new the Republic of New Africa, which is a black nationalist movement in the Deep South. And he, when he got elected, bequeathed a large portion of land, 18 acres, to into a community land trust for cooperative ownership and development of a solidarity economy. So he really wanted to challenge the residents of Jackson to think of how can they create, basically from scratch, a new vision of self-determination. And the community went ahead and developed a plan, a regional plan for development in that area. And the plan, so far, they've restarted a farm that had been abandoned. So they call it the Freedom Farm. And that's the first phase, is developing this farm and developing housing co-ops for members. And then the second phase, which they're working on now, is the development of an eco-village that the Freedom Farm will feed a cafe. The cafe, the waste from the cafe will feed a composting operation, and the composting will go back to the farm, and all of it is supposed to be a beautiful cycle. So they're doing a lot of member-based training on cooperative development and co-op housing. So they're getting a lot of the technical skills that they need to actually put into practice the second phase of their vision. But here's an example of really looking at not just affordable housing. When we think about land use, and it's just certainly one expression of that, but really looking at how they can leverage land for, you know, once it's in land trust, it's in affordable in perpetuity. Democratic Practices, another group that we talked to, is the Kentuckians for the Commonwealth, and they are a membership-based organization in coal country, Kentucky. And so these folks are really grappling with what it means when coal miners are out of work, and how do they transform an economy that's very, very dominated by the coal industry. And they are doing it basically, they're really focused on democratic practices within their organization and then building a base in Kentucky to push back on the coal industry. And they've made some inroads there, surprisingly. I kept asking them, how do you work in Kentucky on energy democracy? And they said the first thing we did is we started to break up rural co-op utilities. I said, oh, co-op utilities, that sounds great. They're like, no, in rural places in Kentucky, rural co-ops mean coal companies own those utilities. They run them, they basically like fiefdoms. And so they began to elect people to rural co-op commissions and break up the power of the coal countries and coal and those utilities. So I'm gonna go quickly through this. Organizing, all of, like I said, all of the organizations are doing base building in their own communities, but they're also thinking about ways that organizing scales across racial and cultural identities and across geographies as well. And many of them are doing political engagement, looking at more deliberative practices in not just basic voter rights and local accountability, but how do they get other people elected and involved in the political process. And then the final one I'll mention is energy democracy. Black Mesa Water Coalition in the Navajo and Hopi territories are working on a 200 megawatt solar array, and they're using this tool that CJA is working on called Reinvest Project, where they're taking divested funds and trying to start pooling them into pools of capital for these sort of micro projects on the ground. So it's another way to try to draw different models of capital for development that's more tied to community control. And then finally, and I can talk more about this on the Q&A, is the scaling, the question of scale. Most of these groups, although they're working intensely at the ground level, are very, very much linked to international movements and solidarity movements across the world. They took 200 delegates, CJA took 200 delegates to COP21, and the purpose of taking those delegates there was really to do this transnational movement building, creating solidarity and alliances with movements and groups of folks across the world with a similar vision. So, you know, they are working and thinking and reflecting on ways that they're building these transnational alliances. And I think I'll stop there because I think I'm over time. But thank you. I think I'm going to invite all the speakers to come up to the table of honor. And I would, you know, I think what I'll do is I'll just take two or three questions at a time, and then we can have the panelists respond.
Good.
So we can try to get as many questions as we can. Just breaking it.
Hello.
All right, so questions from the audience. Wanted to... Yes, Alan.
Timo.
Timo.
Give me a sense of the numbers involved. I mean, how much is going to be saved if you use the carbon for 10 years rather than 2 years of the program? We have a sense of how much is going to be saved.
Of what?
CO2 into the atmosphere, for example.
Let me take one more.
Any quantitative figure you can give me.
Sure. Okay, so we have a question on for Timo on the savings repairable garments. Another question, yes? Timon?
Timon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So just on behalf of another.
Okay, benefits to other inhabitants of the city. Can you connect to me one more? Oh. Yes.
There was two of you, including yourself, Anna, who brought up a kind of no growth or zero growth or growth of a different kind, economic strategies, with our economists at the table. I'm very curious to get your feedback on viabilities, what you... Now, how do you feel about these kind of proposals coming both from the Milana side, policy side, as well as design side? We speak about these all kinds of alternatives, growth of a different kind, not monetary, or no growth.
Okay, so a question I think that could apply to multiple panelists about the viability of different growth, no growth, different kind of growth scenarios for the economy. Do you want to start, Timo,
sure,
on the repairable garment?
Sure. So you asked for a metric, essentially. So I'll give you one, and it needs to be taken into account. It's related to cotton, which is the second largest fiber. So cotton right now, I think, accounts for roughly between 40 to 45% of the global fiber market. Polyester overtook it some years back, and polyester is more than 50%. But cotton is still very significant. And one of the figures that gets sort of shared around a lot is one, and I apologize for being metric, somebody wants to convert it. So 1 kilo of cotton can take up to 2,000 liters to produce, 2,000 liters of water to produce. And that can be the case also with organic cotton, which is cotton that has been grown without certain pesticides and certain types of fertilizers. My view on that is it always needs to be examined in the context of the whole life cycle. Say it is at 2,000 liters per kilo, it can be higher and it can be lower as well. That is all an investment that's made in the fabric and then in the garment. And when you make a garment that somebody wears, say, two times and then throws it out, and there's other researchers who've actually looked at those kinds of timelines, where we have increasing numbers of garments that are thrown out after one wear. So garments aren't actually even laundered. They're just thrown out.
Not in this college, right?
You would hope so, but the reality is sometimes different. That's where significant savings obviously can be made. And then when you start to look at the other components, I mean, you could look at carbon emissions from per garment as well, as well as labor. When just in the last 3 years alone, we've seen the loss of life, particularly in Bangladesh and Pakistan, of thousands of garment workers. you know, I think all of those things need to be accounted for as well, because they are actually the ones that are subsidizing the $5 t-shirts and the $10 pairs of jeans. But so there's lots of different metrics that could be used. I think water is particularly valuable because, or a useful one, because we are heading to an era, or really we are already in an era where, depending on the geographic location, you know, both the land and the water could be used to grow food, or it can be used to grow cotton. And in many parts of the world, and even California, I mean, just here in the US, California is one example where, you know, water is a scarce resource already, and some of that water is used to be used to farm cotton. So the point is, it's useful to look at the sort of general numbers, but also the complexity of the whole life cycle, and also where things come from, needs to be looked at in that.
Excellent, thank you, Timo. So maybe Timon, you want to take the benefits of green connectivity?
Yeah, thank you for your question. So, the sort of, this is a broader sort of proposal, very incremental, and any real, you know, goals about a particular space are going to, I think, in a more ideal setting, be something that is generated by the local community, and that, you know, and this is something that you see in some cases being more or less well done in different parts of the city, where different kinds of green infrastructure or green space are being built out or restored, or in some cases just new things going in. So our goals are really to think about what's possible as sort of an idea space, so that maybe with particular communities we can start working out what would they really like to see in some of these places. And there, I think, is there's no reason that children can't be just as important part of some of these ideas as adults, or sort of non-human species. And the goal of the project is definitely to think about how we increase, how we sort of develop a different kind of transportation network in the city, in particular for connecting up ecological spaces and for that kind of mobility. But if you do this well, I don't know about a majority, but it could be a vast percentage of that could be really about increasing the opportunities for people to move through those spaces. And then probably it's a more about safety and issues like that in terms of what's better for children versus others, and whether it's sort of ground level or, you know, roof level type connections. But we have been actively thinking about these as recreational spaces, spaces that people can use, since we're a lot of ideas out there are about increasing the amount of green space. And so what we're really trying to do is think about how do we channel that in a way that basically gets more bang for the buck in terms of, if you want to have more green space, where can we do that to the most advantage in terms of the ecological functioning of these various spaces by connecting them up. And by benefits, I'm thinking mostly about human benefits, and children are certainly part of that mix. I think it's an important point, though, so thanks for the question.
And then, Willi, I'm going to turn to you first to see if you have any insight in terms of the viability of different no growth or different kind of growth strategies for an economy.
Well, thank you for this question. It's an important question that aims at the question, so to speak, how much can we reduce CO2 emission and environmental damages, and also health damages who come from CO2 emission or other greenhouse gases, through having no growth. So I know roughly the number. So when we have So growth since the middle of the 19th century, or let's say end of 19th century, each family may have had one car in the garage. Cars didn't exist yet, but assume that. Now they have 14 or 15 cars in the garage. That means the income on the GDP per head has grown 30 to 15 times since the end of 19th century. And this is this growth effect that produce a lot of these CO2 emissions.
On the other hand, the reduction of the CO2 emission in the whole time period to conservation of energy was roughly maybe 20-30% of this. So one cannot overdo this, that one can conserve a lot of reduce a lot of CO2 emissions through no growth. This is feasible for, I think, advanced countries. They have now very low growth rates for a decade already. So, and the CO2 emission actually went down through this time period. But it's very hard to argue for developing economies to have no growth there. And so therefore, there's a big conflict, so to speak. Developing economies want to come to a higher per capita income. And so the important question is then, of course, as you mentioned, to have, so to speak, a different kind of growth, a transition to more greener growth with other energy uses, with less damages to the environment or forest, or with damage to agriculture. So there is a different type of growth is now asked for. And I think one has a difficult time to explain to them, with this huge difference in per capita income between the North and the South, to say, no, you shouldn't have any growth now. So this is, I think, a difficult issue.
I mean, I think I'll just add that the communities that CJA represents, in a way, it's easier to look at those communities because those communities have not ever benefited really from the type of development that has, you know, allowed the kind of growth in greenhouse gases and climate change that we see today. They've really been the marginalized communities that have gotten the brunt, sort of the externalities picture of that fossil fuel growth has weighed on these communities the most. So, for example, Black Mesa Water Coalition, here's a community that's home to Peabody, two coal mines, three coal power plants, and 75% of the Navajo and Hopi people don't have electricity. So clearly the kind of development trajectory that has benefited quite a few in the developing and the developed world has not benefited all equally or in the same way. And so this idea of a just transition is really saying to these communities for the benefit of their survival, really, because they have not, you know, unlike some of the middle class that have been able to benefit from that development trajectory and quite comfortable in that development trajectory, these communities say, we have to find other alternatives because the alternative, the development trajectory that we have now doesn't work for us. But the hope is that by articulating and actually trying out some of these alternatives in the communities that are least resourced and the most marginalized, that they can, I mean, I think their hope is to sort of say to the world that there's a possible alternative, right? That there is a way that you can have a sustainable, healthy, you know, rich, regenerative life that's not connected to the same development trajectory that we've had in the past. And so those conversations are happening between the folks in the developed world that have been marginalized, as well as the folks in the developing world, which is what that COP21 delegation was all about, was connecting communities of people in the developed and the developing world who are trying out these alternatives and sort of trying to amplify what's possible to what I think is more of the mainstream communities or very powerful interests that would like to see the development trajectories of the developing world go in the same, in equal way, unequal way. So just transition for a lot of these communities means grappling with the idea of justice, which, and I'll just say the CJA communities have a whole thing on reparations and climate debt. So, you know, that's definitely a more radical notion of what's possible. Whether it's viable, that's what they're trying out. So I think it would be great if we could get two more questions from the audience, or three more questions, particularly for Ivan and Nick here, if there's a question for Ivan and that we can generate. We'll take others too, yeah.
I have a question for Ivan. Just in terms of the philosophy, right, if you could talk at all about the site of virus and that, you know, how climate change might or might not be connected.
Mm-hmm.
And then in terms of, you talked about the social factors of cholera,
mm-hmm.
and I'm curious if that's good news because humans have more control over limiting the amount of cholera that
Okay, let me begin. Thank you for the questions. Let me begin with Zika. Zika's mosquito-borne. It's a virus. It's emerging. So mosquito ecology is climate sensitive. It's environmental sensitive. Some of these mosquito borns are also poverty sensitive, right? So that's important in terms of the background context. So potentially, I think, I'm assuming right now there's ongoing studies or they're looking at the potential of climate change, or more or less, I think what I've seen is that they're looking at examinations that are possibly linking the current El Nino, the Pacific warming, which actually has both rainfall and temperature changes impacts in Brazil, for example. Of course, you see it spreading in other parts of Latin America, but focusing on Brazil, what's very interesting about Brazil is that many of the cases that have been associated with the birth defects have been found in Northeast Brazil. And Northeast Brazil itself is very interesting historically for colonialism and exploitation and extraction. But a lot of people from the Northeast migrate to the South for work, and historically it's a marginalized area associated with poverty, and it's also associated with El Nino droughts. So it's possible that right now there could be some links to El Nino, but you know, I guess part of my work is to really quantify those climate connections and understand pathways, but also create some balance too. Let's bring in other factors and try to explain the social dimensions, which I think are left out a lot, even though we say them. We see these models, but we're not actually trying to measure them or even understand them at the community scale. I think I forgot what your last question was. Is it translatable to other parts of the world? Yes, it is, I think. One, for those places where the reason that I looked at Piura is because they're facing climate change related impacts or similar every few years. There's variability, there's extremes, temperature and changes throughout their country. And other places around the world, especially a lot around the Pacific Rim, are also experiencing that. And they have very similar, not similar impacts, but may have similar coping strategies and similar sort of health impacts that might occur. Cholera specifically, that work I think is to inform what we know about now in Bangladesh. Much of the work that we understand about the link between climate change and cholera, which is pretty well established, is in Southeast Asia. And one of the arguments that's been put forth by not just Peruvians, but me and some others, is that place matters and vulnerability can vary by place, but also so too can those climate changes there. And so what we're extrapolating from Bangladesh and India may not necessarily always be applied everywhere else. And this is kind of to kind of bring this Peruvian story to the picture to say, hey, actually, El Nino can impact disease dynamics some of the times, but other times it's maybe perhaps less important. So there's this balance.
I think we have time for one more question.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, certainly one of the goals for this is to think about strategic points where various kinds of green infrastructure can help ameliorate some of these environmental conditions, some of which are going to be exacerbated by sea level rise. And so they're a particular concern. It's also to think about where are we in the context of New York right now. And one place we are is in the middle of this green infrastructure plan that's spending, I don't know, in the neighborhood of $100, $150 million a year building new green infrastructure, mostly for stormwater absorption. But we have coastal flood issues. We have lots of other issues that are also very amenable to green infrastructure solutions. Not necessarily as a silver bullet, like in some cases, you need much more hard or built infrastructure as part of that solution matrix. But where does this fit in? So we're certainly thinking about the coastal issues as much as we are urban heat island and extreme heat and trying to figure out how do we reduce vulnerability to extreme heat by pro- providing networked green space in neighborhoods that have that as a particular challenge. So, I mean, the goal of projects is really actually to look at multiple kinds of challenges and see where's the sweet spot where we get the sort of most bang for the buck, but not as been done in some other kinds of studies in terms of really just looking for hotspots where green infrastructure is needed, but rather trying to take the long view and say, if you put in a pocket park or a bioswale or you restore some area, but it's highly isolated, what's its potential long-term to actually keep providing the benefits you want? We know fundamentally from ecology that things need to be able to move around or they have to be much more highly managed. So can we, rather than requiring this intensive management, really start thinking about using the nature of ecosystems to manage themselves by connecting them up in other ways? Thanks for your question.
All right, well, I think that's all the time we have. There's another event coming in after, but I want to thank all of our panelists, our faculty members who worked so hard last year on this research project, and we're very proud of the work that you all did and look to feature it prominently at the TEDC, so thank you.
Thank you.